ومولانا بالقاسم محمد
وأهل
بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين ولعنة الله دائما على أعدائهم أجمعين. أما بعد، فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في القرآن الكريم: بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، وما عندكم ينفد وما عند الله باق. صدق الله العلي العظيم. أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I was not expecting to do the khutbah today, so I will try to just make a few remarks in a very short period. The verse which I have just recited is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran that that which is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remains, and that with that which is with us will always fade, is transient. And we always need a reminder in this life. We become very accustomed to the flow of things. We become very accustomed to how we live. We become so accustomed to the day-to-day life we live, our jobs, our families, our pursuit for wealth, our pursuit for material things. And that is why the Quran calls itself a dhikr. That is why the Quran says it is a reminder. The Quran speaks about the fact that this world, when we analyze it in its truest sense, it is transient. It is something which will never remain. We put our full effort in earning money. We put our full effort in having a beautiful household. We put so much effort in having a huge property portfolio. But in the end, what do we have? We put so much effort in these things, and at the end of it, we still feel we are yearning. We still feel we are lacking. That lack, that yearning, that unfulfilled desire can only be fulfilled by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when you look at what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us in compared to this world, we find that what Allah gives us is complete fulfillment, gives us true happiness, and gives us the true meaning of love. Because what we see in this world is nothing but lust. It isn't even a majazi love. It isn't even a virtual metaphorical love. It is, especially in the Western world, where the anthropology, where the complete system of existence and how we look at the world is reduced to materiality. It is reduced to materialness. It is reduced to how fast you can travel from one place to another, how fast you can send a message to the other person. What the Quranic worldview is, and the worldview that the Prophet came with, and the Imams came with, is to awaken what your job has, what is your inner truest sense. What is it that makes you a human being? Today we have so much preaching going on. We have so many people who claim to be saints, spiritual leaders, so many cults formed within, even within Shiaism, Sunnism, there's a cult after cult. At the end of it, what we seek really is to know what it is to be a good human being. As Imam Khomeini rahimahullah said, that it is so easy to become a mullah, but it is very difficult to become a human being. And when we analyze this world and we put it under the microscope, we will see that this world is nothing but a transient, temporary abode. It is something, nothing is fixed. That is why the Quran says that your wealth, your children, your all this is fitna. Why is it a fitna? Because it is there to test you. Because we will seek an immortality in these things. We want to make ourselves immortal. We spread ourselves out so much and create so much anxiety for ourselves. We buy so many houses, so much property, so much this, so much that, and all it gives us is pure anxiety to look after it, to take care of it, to protect your bank balance. These things are timeless reminders that everything here, didn't we see these bankers who had so much money in their bank, but when things collapsed, even though they had so much wealth, they were throwing themselves off buildings? Do we not see these celebrities who seem to have fame, wealth, money, winning, whatever, and yet they are in depression? They are committing suicide. They are going bonkers. They are trying to make themselves look like something which they're not. The whole fact of the matter is that the human being has become disenchanted of himself. The human being has become disillusioned. He is, as the Quran says, وَلَا تَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ نَسُوا اللَّهَ فَأَنْسَاهُمْ أَنفُسَهُمْ. That do not be like those who have forgotten Allah, and those who forget Allah have forgotten themselves. But at the same time, when we are completely remonstrating and speaking against this dunya, we are saying the dunya is full of vice. It is a prison for the believer. It is a place where, for the believer, it is a place where he's continuously under trial and tribulation. And the very word dunya itself means dunya, from dana, dani, something, the lowest form. The material realm is the lowest form of existence. Do we not see, when we have a powerful spiritual experience, when we have a powerful dream, that we suddenly are connected with a different realm? We are connected with a higher realm. This all reminds us that the corporeal, physical, material realm is something so insignificant in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yet at the same time, on the other side of the coin, it does have a significance. رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسْنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسْنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that teaches us, that ask for the goodness of this world and the goodness of the hereafter. As the Quran says, that seek you what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you of the akhirah. وَلَا تَنْسَى نَسِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا. Do not forget your share, your proportion of this world. What does that mean? That everything must be put in its context, and everything must be put on the scale and on the balance of things. In the grand scheme of things, this world is insignificant. But in the scheme of me and you, in the scheme when we look at our lives, this world is nothing for us to grow, for us to learn, for us to become polished. By every trial and by every tribulation we face, in every sense, whatever, however insignificant it may be, not all of us will be tested to the extent when we see suffering to the extent of starvation, famine, murder, bombs falling on us. It might be small tests we suffer in our jobs, in our day-to-day lives, in our families. But everything has its own ahkam. Every situation has its own corollaries. So every human being in his own, in and of himself, if he changes, if he works on himself, he will find the world will change with him. That is why when we see in the verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ, that God does not change the plight of a people until they change themselves. That very fact means that until you change yourself, that to save a human being is like you have saved humanity, and to kill a human being is like you have killed whole of humanity. That all comes down to, if you save yourself, you have saved humanity. If you save yourself from the fire, you have saved the whole of humanity from fire. Because at the end of the day, it is ultimately you and your God. Of course, everything needs to be taken in its context. You cannot say it's such a selfish desire here that, oh, I will save myself. No. But the Quran says, "Qu ahlikum wa anfusakum nar," that save yourselves and your family from the fire. Because the very fact that when you start to work on yourself and start to become a better human being and start to develop your character traits and become truly a person who has progressed, then you will find that those around you will suddenly be experiencing and be affected by a member of society, of a family, of a greater, to a better degree. If you have improved your akhlaq, if you have improved yourself after many years of praying, of many years of being involved in mosque activities or anything, and you still have not changed at all, then there is something significantly wrong there. It is not affecting you. It has become a ritualized, habitualized religion, which has actually has increased you in your bigotry, but not increased you in your being. To change yourself and to save yourself means saving all of humanity, in the sense that when you have started to bring about that inner revolution, what will occur is that when you are dealing with your family, you will be patient. You will start to manifest traits of goodness, of virtue.
And all those traits will have a significant impact on all those around you, just like a stone thrown in an ocean has a ripple effect. That effect will go around. And just as today also is the great, the passing of the great poet of the East, Allama Iqbal. Now, Allama Iqbal was one of the great philosophers, mystics, poets of the Muslim world in this contemporary period. In the last 100 years, Muslims have not produced many great philosophers or great thinkers or reformers as Allama Iqbal. And Allama Iqbal said in one of his poems that if your selfhood or your inner being was to change, it would not be of any surprise that all four dimensions around you, that the world around you will not change. That if this revolution came within you, automatically the world will become revolutionized for you. Because let's face it, we will not be able to stop a war in Syria. We will not be able to stop the famine in Africa. We will not be able to stop the illegal occupations around the world. We will not be able to remove people from power. But what you can do is to reform yourself. And that reformation requires motivation. It requires a sense of resolution. It requires a sense of willpower. We have the willpower to pass our degree. We have the willpower to really expend so much energy in gaining what we want from this world. But do we not want that willpower to gain that true gold, that true treasure, that true wealth? And that person who has that wealth of Iman, has that wealth of Itminan, that has the wealth of Akhlaq, he has the greatest wealth. There is no greater wealth than true knowledge. There is no greater wealth than Akhlaq. There's no greater wealth than being at peace with yourself. And peace with yourself means being at peace with your Creator. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد
اللهم صل على
الحمد لله رب العالمين وبه نستعين وصلى الله على محمد وأهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين أما بعد. Due to the very fact I was not supposed to be giving a khutbah today, any ideas which are coming to my head, and I'd just like to talk about some current things which are going on in the world. And especially we are worried about what is going on in other countries, and our certain countries are transgressing bans, or there are certain things which are imminently occurring, or wars and whatnot are about to, and we know everything which is going on in Syria and everywhere. But the very fact of the matter is that within even the Muslim countries, there is such a cancer of bigotry, of self-righteousness, that it is absolutely shocking. We see that Muslims are killed for no reason, for being called blasphemers, or sectarian strife, or we see people killing, Muslims killing each other, and killing each other with such lack of empathy and with such brutality and lack of mercy. It is completely antithetical and contradictory to what the message of the Prophet was, to what the message of the Imams was. I mean, these people at the same time are mentioning the name of God, they are mentioning the name of the Prophet and calling themselves upholders of the prophetic values, of justice, of the Quran, but it is nothing but a ruse. It is nothing but complete froth. It has no value. You could say the Prophet's name thousands of times a day. You could read the Hajjud, you could read whatever you want. Were not the killers of Hussein alayhi salam people who prayed, who knew the Quran, who knew Islamic values? Were not people who said Yazid was a good ruler? Were they not great philosophers, great thinkers, great theologians? The very fact of the matter is that religion itself can become your greatest idol. Religion itself can become nothing but a bunch of dogma which perpetuates a divisiveness, hatred. I am a Shia, I am greater than a Sunni. By virtue, by the fact I have been born in a Shia family, by my arbitrary nature I have been born in a Shia family, I am suddenly better than all Sunnis. I have suddenly been given the passport to heaven. this self-righteousness within Muslims is absolutely cancerous. And it is destroying communities, it is destroying values of Islam, what Islam really stood for. I mean, that is why we see that great thinkers, they are beyond these things. Great men, great saints, great awliya, Allah are beyond all these sort of false dichotomies. I mean, we could raise the mosque, raise the temple or whatnot, but at the end of the day, that those very values which the Prophet came for, which the Imams came for, let's face it, if the Prophet or the Imam was here, what would they do in any given situation? Would they be blowing up Christian mosques? Would they be killing Ahmadis? Would they be killing people who are blaspheming? Oh, you have blasphemed against the Prophet, you should be killed? No. In fact, the prophetic career, people blasphemed against him. They spat at him, they did so many things to the Prophet, but what was his response? We find that each one of the Imams and the Prophets and the great awliya Allah and the all those great Salihin, their response was always a moral response. Their response was always a response which was upkeeping the Sunnah of Allah. That where we read the hadith, تخلق بأخلاق الله. What is the akhlaq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Is it murdering? Is it having these? And I'm not even talking about extremes like murdering and lynching and all these things. I am taking on the very simple level of when you are talking to your Muslim brother, when you are talking to your Christian brother or sister. I am talking on the very mundane and superficial level of our lives, our simple lives that we live and our interaction with society. As the prophetic hadith, the hadith Qudsi actually said, "Man la yarham la yurham." That person who shows no mercy will not have any mercy shown upon him. And when we see that this self-righteousness, this bigotry, I mean, to be honest, if we were to analyze, forget what a Shia is or what a Muslim is supposed to be, will we, any of us, come and reach that rank of what a Muslim is? We claim to be Muslim, we claim to be this, but if we were to analyze and truly analyze what the Prophet and the Imams had said what a Muslim is, or what the Quran speaks of a Muslim and describes a Muslim, do any of us actually fall upon that category? Forget all those things we do, all those paraphernalia, all that marginal activity we take in. That could just be all arbitrary. It could be just accidents, like painting a wall blue, green, red. The wall itself is there. Is it still that قَصْبَ الْقَصَبْ قُلُوبُهُمْ, that their hearts have become stone? So these things we need to really analyze, that as the Quran continuously exhorts us, if we look at the verses of the Quran, if we look at the life of the Prophet, it is nothing but an invitation to awaken your inner essence. And that inner essence is built upon that fitrah. And that fitrah is something Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala وَنَفَقْتُ فِيهِ بِالرُّوحِ has blown within us. So at the end of the day, that this dunya is not negative. Nothing is actually bad in a way. It is how in the context we put it in, it becomes bad. When we put something into context, because this world is nothing but a reflection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's knowledge. It is nothing but a reflection of His desire to be known. That in its very essence is a phenomenal thing. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us life. The most basic thing, the very basic thing we have is a sense of consciousness to know things, to be able to think, to be able to even stand in front of Allah and be able to protest in front of Him, protest our existence. The very fact Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given this non-entity existence by His merciful breath is nothing but something we should be in prostration all our lives and saying thank you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why the Prophet said, أَفَلَا أَكُونُ عَبْدًا شَكُورًا. Should I not be an abdan shakir? Today we have people who have 20 titles before their names. They need to have a certain dress. They need to be of such a nature. But the Prophet would be sat amongst his companions. Nobody would recognize. They said, مَنْ مِنْكُمْ مُحَمَّدُ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. Imam Ali alayhi salam would sleep on a wooden bed, which was so, he used to turn it over the next day and put feed on it for his goats, and then he would sleep on it. I mean, if any one of us could actually live, who claim to follow the Prophet, who we claim to follow the Imam Ali, we chant huge names in, slogans in his remembrance, if any one of us actually did claim to follow the Prophet and the Imams, we would be so humbled, we would be so in awe of these true human beings, not comic heroes, not supermen, in the sense that they are so aloof from us. We don't understand. When we give them humanity, we realize their greatness. When we make them human beings, and I'm not saying human beings in a derogatory sense, because as the Prophet says that إِنَّمَا عَنَا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ يُحَذِرُ, that except I have a, I'm a human being like you, except I receive revelation. It shows us that these are the days of the Mi'raj al-Mustafa, that the Mi'raj al-Mustafa teaches us that the pinnacle of humanity is Qaba Qawsayn. It shows us that the human being has so much capacity within him, even though you may never reach it. But it shows you that even if you reach a small inkling, a small proportion of what the Prophet taught us, we will truly become liberated human beings. And when I say liberated human beings with faith and with knowledge and values, it does not mean you will be living a life of luxury. You'll be chilling. You won't be chilling, because when you are a true believer, when you are an Abdul Mu'min, you will be trialed, you will be tested, you will be put under the kosh, and you will then emerge with a greater sense of being. Your being will be more intense. Your being will be something which has a greater degree of value. Although when the penny drops, when we're 60, 70, 50, and whenever God decides to take our soul, if we have not changed within ourselves and within our being, we have not achieved anything from the dunya. وَلَنْ يُؤَخِّرَ اللَّهُ نَفْسًا إِذَا جَاءَ أَجْلُهَا, that then there will be not a delay once the ajal has come. So let us pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us to the true path, to illuminate our hearts with faith, iman, and knowledge. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us to the true path of Muhammad and his holy progeny. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless all those people who are suffering around the world, who are in health, or who have problems and tribulations. May Allah help them. May Allah help all those Muslims in Palestine, in Iraq, in Afghanistan, in Kashmir, who are suffering. May Allah ease them in Syria. May Allah ease them their burden. And may Allah hasten the reappearance of the 12th Imam and give us the grand boon of martyrdom at his hand. اللهم صل وسلم على سيدنا محمد المصطفى وعلى علي المرتضى وعلى سيدة نساء العالمين فاطمة الزهراء وعلى سيدي شباب أهل الجنة حسن والحسين وتسعة المعصومين من ذرية الحسين علي بن حسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد وحسن بن علي والحجة والفرح هذه المهديمة عجل الله تعالى قوله الشريف.